So how often do you think about your name? You know, do you think about your name and the impact that your name has on your life? And in fact, they've found out that, you know, research has suggested that your name actually has tremendous impact on your life. For example, if your name is easier to pronounce, you'll be favored. And if your name is easy to pronounce, people will call on you more often in meetings. I've had this first experience, first-hand experience, at many Zoom meetings I've been on with other people. And I introduce myself, and whoever's hosting the meeting will say, and start asking questions, and they'll ask Jim, and they'll ask Bob, and they'll ask Sally, and then they'll say, and Mr. Barnes, what do you think? Because they don't even want to go with my name. But they say if your name is well and is common, you'll be more likely to be hired. And here's two interesting things. If your name is closer to the beginning of the alphabet, you are likely to get into a better school. And if your name is closer to the end of the alphabet, you're likely to be a compulsive spender. I don't know how they figure that one out. So I'm obviously not a compulsive spender. But you know, we judge people by their names. People are judged by their names. For example, if you had someone in school that bullied you, that name will always have a negative context in your mind when you think about it. I know I always think negatively of people by the name of Chester. It was something that happened to me in elementary school. And the names have history with us. We judge people by their names. My name, as you all know, is very hard to live with. And doing some research, I found that in Gaelic it means New Ireland, and in the English language it actually means noble stone. I'm like, well, that's encouraging. I wish you'd tell the whole world that, because it's still hard to pronounce. But our names identify ourselves. You know, we're identified by our names, and people know us by our names. But Jesus himself identified himself in many different ways. He identified himself with different metaphors as he went through his ministry. He would say, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus identified himself in many different ways. And in fact, in his ministry, we're going to look at that through this next few weeks leading up to Resurrection Sunday, where Jesus in John 11:25 said, I am the resurrection and the life. So this series is essentially all about the I ams of Jesus, how he identified himself, how he declared to the world who he was. And not everybody responded with approval to the I ams of Jesus, as we will see. So turn with me today as we begin with John chapter 8. And it's John chapter 8, verse 48 to 59. And the most powerful declaration that Jesus made of who he is and the repercussions that came from that. So John chapter 8, beginning at verse 48. The Jews answered him, are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon? Jesus answered, I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. The Jews said to him, now we know that you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets, yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died, and the prophets died? Who do you make yourself out to be? Jesus answered, if I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father, Abraham, rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, you're not yet 50 years old, and you have seen Abraham? Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Jesus was addressing a group of religious leaders, and they were directly accusing him of identifying himself a certain way, and it was getting aggressive. Jesus wasn't holding back, and they weren't holding back in their accusations of him. In fact, in verse 44, Jesus accused the religious leaders of being children of Satan, saying, you're children of Satan. So they pushed back, and they escalated their attacks. Verse 48, they said, are we not right in saying that you're a Samaritan and that you have a demon? Now, the Samaritans were hated by the Jews. They were not full Jewish blood. They were a mixed race, and they hated each other. And there was a lot of animosity between them. And in fact, one of the worst insults that you could give to a Jew was to say, you're a Samaritan. But then to add to that, they said that Jesus was demon-possessed, adding fuel to their insult. And Jesus, he simply denies their claims. He restrains himself. And then he says, truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. And they respond, well, now we know you have a demon. You're speaking like a demon-possessed man now. You're speaking crazy. And then they go back to the father of their nation, Abraham. And they point to the fact that Abraham and all the prophets died. How can you, this demon-possessed Samaritan, they called him, say that if people believe in you, they'll never die? Essentially, they pose the question with a strong attitude, and they say, who do you think you are? Just who do you think you are? And Jesus responds. I want to read this passage again, but listen carefully what he says. Verse 54 to 56. Jesus answered, if I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you've not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I'd be a liar like you. But I do know him and keep his word. Your father, Abraham, rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. This is actually incredible. We have this passage, and we view it through the lens of the church age, where we stand now in history. And so we have a significant amount of insight into what Jesus was saying, that to them, it must have sounded absolutely ridiculous. The bold statements that Jesus was making. Firstly, he says, God is my father, but Abraham is your father. Any self-respecting Jew would say, Abraham's my father. But Jesus didn't say that. Rather, he was saying that God is my father. That was a groundbreaking statement to make at that time. He was beginning to reveal his true identity. He's beginning to reveal who he really was. And then he says that Abraham saw him in this day. In the day that they were alive then, he said, Abraham saw this. He saw me now. How did Abraham see our Lord's day? How did Abraham see the Lord's life and ministry on the earth? Well, he saw it by faith. He saw it by faith in Hebrews 11:10. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations whose architect and builder is God. Abraham could see. God gave him special insight, special revelation, and wisdom into the Lord's life and ministry to give him the perception to see future events. So Abraham walked by faith. Hebrews 11 was all about the great heroes of faith. How did Abraham see that day? By faith. God had given that to him. Abraham's life, have you thought about this? Abraham's life was a prophetic ministry. His whole life was a story prophesying about Jesus. Have you ever thought about that? The birth of Isaac was miraculous, just like the birth of Jesus. When Abraham God called him to sacrifice his son Isaac. It was a picture of what Jesus did on the cross as God the Father sacrificed his own son for us. In the heavenly priesthood of Melchizedek that Abraham was able to be a part of in Genesis 14, he'd see the priesthood of Jesus, as Hebrews 7 calls Jesus, in the line of the priesthood of Melchizedek. Abraham witnessed that. And in the marriage of Isaac in Genesis 24, Abraham saw a picture of the marriage of Jesus in the church. So Abraham's life was a picture of Jesus. He saw it in his life by faith. Abraham was the father of the nation. And they knew, they'd studied Abraham, they'd studied his life, they knew what he was all about, and they knew that his descendant, the descendant of Abraham, would produce the Messiah. So they understood that, and they pushed back with logic towards Jesus. They said, so the Jews said to him, you're not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham? And then Jesus gives the statement that's the final mic drop statement in the argument. Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. I am. Jesus wasn't simply saying that he was born before Abraham. He was saying, I am. I've always existed. Jesus is declaring his eternal nature. He's declaring the fact that he was never created. He is the uncreated creator of all things with eternal existence. He's no origin. Jesus is saying, I am God. Their response obviously was understandable. The Mosaic law required that if somebody committed blasphemy, they be stoned. And so they picked up stones. Verse 59 says to throw at him. And Jesus divinely hid himself and slipped away because his hour had not yet come. Now, John's Gospel, if you read through John's Gospel, you'll see a number of times where people try to kill Jesus, and he just slipped away. He evaded them. How he did it, I don't know. It's stuff of science fiction movies. But Jesus' hour had not yet come, and he slipped away. But Jesus was directly revealing himself to these religious leaders. He was saying, this is who I am. And they were blinded by religion. They were blinded by their religion of what they knew to be true in their mind. They had it all figured out. They knew the Messiah was coming. They knew that they were the chosen nation, that Israel was chosen by God. They knew in their mind that we're special and the Messiah is coming, but the Messiah is going to be this mighty military leader that overthrows Rome and establishes this great Israeli empire once again. That was their religion. That's what they knew to be true. And that's why when Jesus came, they missed it and they crucified the Messiah. They missed it because of their religion. You know, today there's the most difficult people to invite into a relationship with Jesus Christ as Lord are the religious people. What are religious people? The church is full of religious people. Religious people are those that have got it all figured out. Maybe they went to a meeting and raised their hand, or they filled in a form and said, I want to follow Jesus. Maybe they even went forward in a meeting. Maybe they recited a prayer of salvation, but they don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe they feel that, well, if I just need to go to church at least twice a month, and I definitely need to give something to the church if I want to be blessed. That's religion. That's not relationship. And if you walk by religion, you miss the Messiah. Just like these religious leaders did. Religion is head knowledge. It doesn't save you from the eternal fires of hell. That's what we're talking about. It's life and death. And tragically, this is the state of many people in the church today. And you can see it because they don't have a desire for a relationship with Jesus. There's no desire for relationship with Jesus because they got the boxes checked. They got everything done, but they want to keep living in the world and just check the boxes so that I'll go to heaven one day. Well, sadly, you'll be disappointed. Jesus called these religious leaders children of the devil. He pulled no punches. He said, "You are children of the devil. Today, whose child are you? Whose child are you? Is God your father because you have died to self and given your life to the lordship of Jesus Christ? It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ," as Paul says in Galatians chapter 2. John writing about Jesus said, "He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." Or is Satan your father? That sounds terrible. But if you're depending on a counterfeit righteousness of doing good works and trying to do good things, you don't have your heavenly father as God. Works of righteousness. You know, salvation is not dependent on a balance of good works versus bad works. Somehow thinking, well, if I do enough good things, it'll outweigh the bad things I've done in my life, and that way, one day, hopefully, I'll get into heaven. You'll be surprised how many people live and walk that way daily, thinking they can do enough good. You cannot do enough good. There's only one way to be saved, and that's through Jesus Christ. It truly is a matter of life or death. Getting back to the statement that made the Jewish religious want to kill Jesus. He says, "Before Abraham was, I am." That sounds like a confusing statement, but in understand that, we have to go back to Exodus chapter 3. When God called Moses, in Exodus chapter 3, Moses is a shepherd walking around in the wilderness, and God calls him, speaks to him from a burning bush. The Israel nation, the Hebrew people, had been in Egypt for 400 years. They were slaves. They'd been enslaved by the Egyptian Pharaoh and their people. And they were a far cry from the promises that God had given them to through Abraham. They were not living up to the promises that they had. And Moses himself had been miraculously saved. And you know the story, he was hidden in the bulrushes in the river, and Pharaoh's daughter found him, and he was miraculously saved. He was raised in Pharaoh's house. He was educated. He had authority. He had power. He had potential to be one of the great influences in Egypt. As a Hebrew man, he could have had significant influence. And one day, he killed an Egyptian, seeing him beating an Israeli or Hebrew slave, and he kills him. And so Moses flees the coming punishment. Moses flees for his life, and he ends up spending 40 years working as a shepherd for Jethro, which was his father-in-law, in the land of Midian. God couldn't use Moses until he had prepared him. And how did he prepare him? He humbled him. In our mind, Moses was prepared when he was 40 years old. He was ready. He had influence. He had education. He had power. He had authority. And God said, "I want to strip all that away." And he humbled him. He broke him. He had no self-esteem. He was willing to live out the rest of his days in his insignificance. He didn't want to be known. He was 80 years old, and God called him, appointed him, commissioned him, because God had prepared him. God had readied him to be the one that would lead the children of Israel out of Egypt into the promised land. God tells Moses, "Go to Pharaoh and tell him, let my people go." Moses says back to God, and Moses, remember, has low self-esteem, and he doesn't want the assignment, he doesn't want the job. "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Who am I?" He's a broken 80-year-old who has no hope for a future. And if you think about it, Moses, right from his birth, do you know the name Moses literally means scooped out of the water? It's not a name of a powerful leader. It's just a, you know, a thing that you'd scoop off the top of the water. He was saved. And literally, his name was not associated with power or leadership or authority. And God says, I sent you. And he says, well, who are you, God? In verse 13 of Exodus chapter 3, who are you, God? Who should I tell them that sent me? Because he knew very well that the nation of Egypt, they worshiped many foreign gods. Who shall I tell them sent me? And he knew that if he came and said, God sent me, they're going to say, which God? Why is your God any different to the other gods? And God gives this most powerful revealing statement in all of the Bible up to this point about his own identity. God says to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Up to this point in the Bible, God is identified by the Hebrew word Elohim, which means God. But now God's changing it. Verse 14, he says, I am who I am. I am who I am. I always was, always will be, the unchanging God, pre-existent, always existent. I am. You know that I am is obviously present tense. Now, I often tell people, I said, you know, God's ways are higher than our ways. The Bible tells us that. And we, you know, if we begin to understand God, then he'll no longer be God. Well, here's a little example of how difficult it is for us to wrap our mind around the things of God. Because God is I am in the past. He is I am in the present. And he's I am in the future. You're sitting here and you're thinking about what you did yesterday. If you worked hard, your muscles are aching. But it's in the past. You can't change it. Then you're thinking about today, what you're doing and sitting here right now. And you're thinking about this afternoon, what you're going to do. Or maybe tomorrow. You're looking towards the future. It's uncertain. But God is present in the past. He's present in the present. And he's present in the future. All perfectly. All equal. And if that hurts your mind, you're beginning to grapple with who God is. He is I am. The two words I am pronounced in the Hebrew is Hava in verse 14. And God uses the word I am and Yahweh has sent you interchangeably. Between I am has sent you and Yahweh has sent you, the Hebrew name for God. And from this time onwards, God is known by this statement, I am Yahweh. And it's a complex name because God calls himself that, but the Hebrew people hold it with such honor that they don't even pronounce it. They don't even say Yahweh. They will say Elohim or Adonai, which means Lord. But Yahweh, when you see in your Bibles, and it's all caps, L-O-R-D, all capital letters, that's Yahweh. And when it's capital L-O-R-D in the Hebrew, it's Elohim. Or in the Greek, I've lost it. Anyway, Adonai, you know, and it's the Hebrew. But how does God identifies himself here as Yahweh? I am Yahweh. It's just four letters. There's no vowels, only consonants in the Hebrew language, which makes it very difficult to learn. But if you look up on the screen, that's how it's written in the Hebrew from right to left, and it's translated as Lord in most of our Bibles with all caps, L-O-R-D. Some translators will say in their Bibles it is Jehovah, but in fact that's not correct. Jehovah actually comes from a 16th century German translator that added in vowels to Yahweh and created this word Jehovah. but it's not correct. And if you went to Eric's class a few weeks ago, you would have learned that as well. But God said to Moses, I am Yahweh. And that same word, Yahweh, is used in verse 12. I will be with you. I am the Lord, and I am with you. I am, I will be, and I am with you is all wrapped up in the name of God. So isn't it interesting that one of the names of God, the name of God, is a promise of God's presence with us? Isn't that amazing? You know, we were talking a little while ago, and I mentioned a few weeks ago how I wrestle with and struggle with when we pray be with prayers. That's, you know, when people just sit in prayer meetings and pray for people, say, be with them. The Lord's name says, I will be with you. It's a promise of his name. Wherever you are, I will be. God says to Moses, I am with you. I am there. The name of God, Yahweh, speaks of his eternal existence, his majesty, his transcendence and his immanence, his majesty and his nearness to us. What a promise for Moses. What a promise for Moses and the call of God on his life. God gives him that name to identify himself. So getting back to Jesus, when he said before Abraham was, I am. Now, he was speaking Aramaic. He wasn't speaking Hebrew. But they got it. They knew what he was saying. And that's why they picked up stones to stone him. Remember that the Israel nation had been taken into captivity for at least two generations into Babylon, and they'd had their languages mixed up, so Aramaic came out of that, and then Greek came from the Greek occupation. But Jesus saying, I am, was declaring that he was God himself. He wasn't just a good man. And in their minds, they knew that that was blasphemy. And according to the law of Moses, he had to be killed. So they picked up stones to stone him, to put him to death. So what does this mean for us today? As Jesus has identified himself to the religious leaders, what does it mean for us today? I think there's four things I want to close with quickly. Firstly, Jesus is God. He is not just a good man. He's not just a historical figure, not a tragic figure of someone that died on the cross, tragically. Now, he was born of a virgin, conceived by the Holy Spirit. Jesus was sinless. You know, the sin nature that we all have is carried down through the line of Adam. And Jesus, being conceived by the Holy Spirit, did not have that sin nature. He was sinless. In fact, if Jesus was born normally without the conception of the Holy Spirit, he would carry a sin nature, and in fact, his death on the cross would have no impact on us. It would not have any effect. It would have been worthless. But Jesus knew no sin. He was perfect. His sacrifice was perfect for our sins. And secondly, Jesus saves. You're back in Exodus. Yahweh, the great I am, he kept his promise. He took the children of Israel out of Egypt and eventually got them into the promised land. He rescued them. He saved them by Jesus saying, I am. He is the Savior. He is the one that can save us. The name Jesus in Hebrew is Yeshua, which means Yahweh saves. His name means God saves. Yahweh saves. And Yeshua leads us out of slavery. He leads us out of slavery and bondage to sin and into eventually the promised land, our eternal home with Jesus himself. Jesus is present. Thirdly, Jesus is present. The I am is forever present. He is not remote. He is not distant. He's not a way off. He is present with you right now. If you're a follower of Jesus and truly know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have the Spirit of Christ in you. He is with you. The I Am is present in your life. You're never alone. And then Jesus will give us a new name. He'll give us His name. In Revelation 22, John's given this vision of heaven and our life in this new Jerusalem, the new kingdom. And in verse 4, he writes, they will see His face and His name will be on their foreheads. We'll get the name of Jesus, His name on our foreheads, to identify us, but also to say we are His children, but we belong. We belong there. We'll be given His name. Is that where you belong? Is that where you belong? Peter's standing before the religious leaders in Acts chapter 4. He makes this profound statement about the name of Jesus. Salvation is found in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. There is no other name for salvation but Jesus. You know, today we're going to remember the Lord's Supper and communion. And we're going to do this in a few moments. But if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today is the day for you to give your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. There is no other name whereby we can call on to be saved. And He is, I Am. He promises to save. He promises to be with you. He promises to give you a new name. So normally before we go into communion, I always allow a time of contemplation, a time of just asking the Lord. And if you're a follower of the Lord, maybe you've been a Christian for many, many years, but we all need to prepare our hearts to receive the communion elements. Don't enter it into lightly because of what Jesus has done for us. This is a serious moment as we remember His body broken for us and His blood shed for us. Maybe you have some unforgiveness in your life. Maybe there's some gossip you've been entering in. You realize, oh, I need to just repent of that. Maybe I need to go and speak to someone and make that right. We need to prepare our hearts to worship together. The worship team is going to come up now and lead us in a song before we celebrate communion together. But while they're leading us in that song, you can stand and sing if you want, but you can stay seated. I just want us to have a time of just reflection on what and who Jesus is and what He means to us. And I want you to spend that moment. You may decide to come up and kneel in the front. You may sit where you are. You may stand and raise your hands in worship. However the Lord is calling you to respond today, just respond to Him before we have a time of remembering what He has done for us. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank You. We thank You for who You are. Oh, Jesus, we thank You that You are I Am. We thank You that You died for our sins, that You promised, and You are saving us. Thank You for the gift of salvation that's so free. Thank You, Lord, that there's no good works that we can do that can save us, but only Your blood. And so, Lord, we thank You and praise You for Your word. And I pray, Lord, that You would speak to each and every one of us today, now, right now. We wouldn't leave this place with unfinished business with You. Draw us to Yourself, we pray, into a closer relationship with You. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.